going to start shortly, so we'd like you all to take your seats as quickly as possible. Well, let's go ahead on and start. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Scott Brown, and it is my pleasure to be your master of ceremonies this evening. This evening marks the 15th anniversary of the Thurgood Marshall Lecture and Dinner, and I am pleased to be part of this honored occasion. This year, the Bunche Center is celebrating four important milestones: the 100th anniversary of Ralph Bunche's birth, the 50th anniversary of the landmark Brown versus Board of Education decision, and the 35th anniversary of the Bunche Center, and of course, the 15th Thurgood Marshall event that we're celebrating at this point. Now, in its 35th year, the Ralph Bunche Center for African American Studies is entering a new phase of continued excellence and increased scholarly activity. Of course, I'm speaking from a totally objective point of view. The center fulfills its mission by promoting research and academic programs, maintaining a library, putting on special projects, and publishing current work in African American studies. It is one of the leading centers of its kind in the U.S. And leading the center in his third year as director is Professor Darnell Hunt. Darnell Hunt is director of the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies and professor of sociology here at UCLA. Dr. Hunt has written extensively on race and media, including two recent books, first of which, Screening the Los Angeles Riots, Race, Seeing, and Resistance, and a second book on called O.J. Simpson, Facts and Fictions, News, Rituals, in the Construction of Reality. Both of these books were published with Cambridge University Press. He is also the editor of a forthcoming four-volume series from Oxford University Press on African Americans and media. The first volume, edited by Dr. Hunt, is entitled Channeling Blackness, Studies on Television and Race in America. And it's due out early this year. Prior to his academic career, Dr. Hunt worked in the media as a researcher with the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, the 1993 hearings on diversity in Hollywood. As Bunche Center director over the past 3 years, Dr. Hunt has managed research, outreach, and publicity campaigns aimed at making the center a household name in the region's black community, as well as in intellectual circles throughout the nation and beyond. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you, as director of the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Darnell Hunt.
Well, thank you, Scott. It is my pleasure to welcome you all here this evening. However, before I go on, I'd like to inform you that Larry McCormick had hoped to join us this evening as our Master of Ceremonies, but he is unable to do so. We look forward to him joining us again next year as our MC, and we are greatly appreciative of his service to this event in years past. Now it's my distinct pleasure to introduce to you one of my dynamic faculty colleagues here at UCLA, who has graciously agreed to serve as your MC in Larry's place this evening, Professor Scott Brown. Lots to say. Scott Brown joined the faculty at UCLA last year as an assistant professor of history. His area of expertise is African American history, with a special focus on social and cultural movements such as the Black Power movement. He received his PhD in history from Cornell University. His recent book, and I urge you all to take a look at it, it's fascinating reading, Fighting for Us, Molana Karenga, the US Organization, and Black Cultural Nationalism, came out 2003, New York University Press. It's been creating quite a stir in intellectual circles. Needless to say, we are thrilled to have Professor Brown here at UCLA and at the center, and I am personally grateful that he has agreed to serve as our MC this evening. Now I'd like to just take a few moments to recognize some special individuals in attendance this evening. First, I'd like to recognize the many current UCLA students who are present. Could you all stand? They, of course, are one of the important reasons why we are here this evening. They represent the next generation of scholars and leaders. Please take time to chat with them this evening as you enjoy the program. Next, I'd like to acknowledge some other special attendees. First of all, we have Winston Doby, Vice President, Educational Outreach, UC Office of the President. Well, I don't believe he's here, but I know he's going to be joining us at some point, so we'll remember him with the applause. We have Claudia Mitchell Kernan, Vice Chancellor, Graduate Studies. Dr. Derek Marshall, representing the Thurgood Marshall family. State Senator Richard A. Alicorn. Anika Makisi, USAC President. For those of you who don't know acronyms around here, we're talking about the student body president here at UCLA. The Bunche Center Faculty Advisory Committee members, could you please stand? Faculty. All right, now the Community Advisory Board, the Bunche Center Community Advisory Board, 45 members strong. And last but not least, the Student Advisory Committee for the Bunche Center. Could you please stand? We have four other members. This evening's event, of course, would not have been possible without the generous support of our many sponsors, and they are as follows: Toyota, Fox Studios, Northrop Grumman Corporation, Winston Doby, UC Office of the President Educational Outreach, Renee Campbell, the CARE Foundation, Claudia Mitchell Kernan, UCLA Graduate Division, Nestle, Rita Rothman, Second Baptist Church, Peter Taylor, Oscar Turner, UCLA Black Faculty and Staff Association, UCLA Black Alumni Association, and the UCLA Office of Community Partnerships. As you know, and as Scott alluded to earlier, the center is celebrating four important milestones this year. First, we have the 100th anniversary of Ralph Bunche's birth, the Nieman portrait behind us on the screen. The 50th anniversary of the landmark Brown versus Board of Education decision. The 35th anniversary of the center. And of course, the 15th Thurgood Marshall event. In light of this special convergence, we felt it appropriate to break tradition with past dinners and honor Thurgood Marshall himself for his outstanding contributions to civil and human rights. We are particularly grateful for our three distinguished speakers this evening: Juan Williams, Connie Rice, and our own Kimberle Crenshaw. Each will provide us with a particular perspective on Thurgood Marshall's storied career and on the enduring legacy of the Brown decision. Now it is my pleasure to introduce to you a brief 4-minute video about the Bunche Center, recently produced by one of our second year Afro-Am master's students, Aaron Randolph. Aaron? But before I leave, I'd like to express my gratitude to each of you for your support this evening. I look forward to connecting with you throughout the evening. Thanks again. Please begin the video.
Parents realized they wanted a better education for their children.
Nearly 200 students and parents signed on to sue the all-white Board of Education. Segregationists reacted immediately.
There were Klansmen who came from all over the United States to intimidate people. They burned a cross down on the athletic field out there that was so huge and so hot that grass never grew there in that spot again.
The community held firm, and the lawyers went to work. Prince Edward case became part of the NAACP's push to overturn segregation through the courts. A strategy they had pursued for decades under the guidance of Thurgood Marshall. After two long years, the Prince Edward County case, along with four others, finally made it all the way to the Supreme Court. Collectively, five cases came to be known as Brown versus Board of Education.
Our case, Davis versus Prince Edward County, is the only case that was stood in there. The rest of them were initiated by adults. That was the only case whereby students walked out and got something.
May 17, 1954, the Supreme Court declared, in the field of public education, the doctrine of separate but equal has no place. Segregated schools, the court said, are inherently unequal.
I remember the exact moment where I was sitting in the 11th grade. I remember the principal rang the bell to tell us in so many words that the Supreme Court had just declared schools like the ones in which we were sitting unconstitutional. The whole school sprang up. Teachers, some of whom had PhDs, broke down and cried. It was as if they never believed that this would happen.
Ralph Ellison said, the court has recognized our human psychological complexity and citizenship. What a wonderful world of possibilities are unfolded for the children. The Supreme Court decision was the beginning of a revolution.
Okay, obviously that was not a video about the center. That was actually a preview of a forthcoming documentary on the Brown case, and you got to see it first here. We're working on that after the center piece. We will now see the piece on the center.
For the past 35 years, the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies has been committed to promoting and studying the rich history and culture of the African diaspora. Out of the 1960 struggle for equality and recognition on the UCLA campus and around the nation, the Bunche Center was born. Founded in 1969 as the Center for Afro-American Studies, the Bunche Center is the culmination of plans by the black students on campus and their supporters to provide the UCLA population with an intellectual home for acknowledging and studying their history and culture. At UCLA, things came to a head when two Black Panthers were killed in Campbell Hall in January 1969 after a clash over who would lead the new center. Students all over the United States were fighting to have African American studies recognized as a legitimate field of study during the 1960s. But since this tragic event, the Bunche Center has been a positive force for academic and social change at UCLA, as well as in the broader community. Today, it is generally recognized as one of the top research units in the nation devoted to African American studies. The Bunche Center Library and Media Center is home to more than 7,000 books, dozens of journals, and several special collections, including volumes 1 and 2 of the Frederick Douglass Papers, the Marcus Garvey and the Universal Negro Improvement Papers, volume 1 of the Papers of Martin Luther King Jr., and the Kenny Burrell Archive of African American Music. Engaged in the production of knowledge and in the education of future scholars and leaders, but it also presents socio-culture events such as the annual Thurgood Marshall Lecture and Dinner, the Circle of Thought Brown Bag Lecture Series, book signings and lectures, and periodic conferences and symposia.
We congratulate UCLA, but more importantly, we are looking forward to the next Ralph Bunche. More importantly, we are counting to make sure that there are more Ralph Bunches, because they're in your midst now. So on behalf of the Speaker of the State of California, we want to say thank you and ask you to hang this prominently in the Ralph Bunche Center. Thank you.
Thank you.
runny. Well, we hope you're enjoying your meal, but we're going to move right along with the program as you continue to dine. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite to the rostrum very distinguished and important figure, particularly to the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies and all those interested in continually to democratize the presence of people of color in higher education, and that is Senator, California State Senator Richard Alarcon. And he is the chair of the Select Committee on College and College Admissions and Outreach. So he has a very special place for those of us here at the Ralph Bunche Center, and we'd like to welcome him at this point.
Thank you. It's a tremendous pleasure to be here to recommit to the legacy of Thurgood Marshall and Ralph Bunche. I chair the Select Committee on College and University Admissions and Outreach, and I wish I had better news to bring, but the fact of the matter is there is a reversal of the tide in Sacramento, and so it would not be more appropriate than today to have this convening to rediscuss the issues of educating our young instead of incarcerating our young. And so, but my specific task tonight is to introduce our very special guest speaker. I do want to say just a couple of words. I am a politician, so I will say just a couple of words. Number one, it is so sad to watch the movie about the outhouses at the school and know that today the state of California is in a battle for just that same subject in schools in our school systems throughout California. The Williams case is pending, and I want to let you know that I absolutely believe that we should not pass a budget unless the schools are fully funded to the extent that they can provide restrooms and toilet paper to our children. Secondly, I do believe we have to rethink our cuts in outreach programming and the ethnic institutes, which reflect California's people more than the other institutions. And so I want to applaud the Bunche Center for your continued inspiration, but know that that I will join with my colleagues who support your cause to fight to ensure that your institution gets a fair cut, if any, and that it does not see what I consider to be a discriminatory cut at 25% as proposed by this governor. We have to fight to preserve the integrity of this program. Okay, I'll stop talking politics. Never. It's a pleasure to be here in honor of one of America's greatest legal thinkers, Thurgood Marshall. Paved the way for many of us in this room to receive a quality education through his participation in Brown versus Board of Education. It is sad that to this day, quality education is only a dream for many of our youth and, in fact, our adults who are attending colleges. But we are fortunate that we have great people like Thurgood Marshall that through their actions have provided us with guidance as to how to improve the lives of our young people through education. It's because of efforts engaged in by people such as Justice Marshall that I have been inspired to try to fight for quality education and, in fact, do have a measure to challenge our kids to more rigorous coursework, not believing that they can't accomplish, but believing that they can if challenged. I believe our schools should have AP courses and college prep courses and the opportunities to learn so that they can advance forward. And so we're fighting that fight, but it's an uphill battle. And the Bunche Center, like the challenges that we are facing in education in Sacramento, is fighting day in and day out to preserve that legacy. It was Ralph Bunche himself who said, "I am a professional optimist." And he defined optimism as the sense of assuming that there is no problem that cannot be solved. Now, 100 years after Bunche was born, we can also celebrate the 50th anniversary of desegregation and 35 years of this great institution. So tonight I am honored to introduce another symbol of progress that can put us all into a perspective like few others in this country can do, because Juan Williams believes. He believes that knowledge is the key to problem solving and has spent much of his time spreading the message of civil rights, the civil rights movement, and of successful African Americans through his books. He is author of Thurgood Marshall, American Revolutionary, and in it, he chronicles Marshall's fight to outlaw segregation and, of course, Brown versus Board of Education. Williams also wrote the bestseller Eyes on the Prize about America's civil rights years, and he is host of America's Black Forum, the nationally syndicated TV show, and political analyst for Fox News Channel. He's a regular panelist on Fox News Sunday. Mr. Williams began his journalistic career more than 20 years ago at the Washington Post. He has served the paper as a police reporter, editorial writer, columnist, and White House correspondent. And articles by Mr. Williams have appeared in magazines ranging from Fortune, The Atlantic Monthly, to Ebony, Gentleman's Quarterly, and The New Republic. Of course, he's winner of several journalism awards for reporting and commentary. Mr. Williams has also won an Emmy Award for TV documentary writing. He's written a series of critically acclaimed documentaries, including Politics, The New Black Power, Marian Anderson, and A. Philip Randolph for Jobs and Freedom. Juan Williams is a man who, with his writing, is documenting the civil rights movement, and in doing so, he is preserving and protecting our civil rights and expanding Thurgood Marshall's legacy. And so I am pleased and honored to present a champion for civil rights, Juan Williams. All right.
Senator, thank you very much. What an honor, what a pleasure it is for me to be here with all of you tonight for this very special occasion. Let me say that at the reception outside, some of you came up to me and said that you listened to me on National Public Radio and were surprised to see what I look like. Well, I didn't know what you look like either. Keep that in mind. As I was saying, it's a great pleasure to be here this year, on this occasion, for this Thurgood Marshall Lecture at the Bunche Center. This is a special year, as you know, 50 years after Brown versus Board of Education, and the idea that you would have invited me to deliver this lecture tonight about Justice Marshall, I consider a signal honor, and I deeply appreciate it. I thought I would start out by recounting a conversation that I had with Justice Marshall toward the end of his life. I'll tell you the situation. I had done several months of interviews with Justice Marshall for a magazine piece to appear in the Washington Post magazine. And after doing these interviews, Justice Marshall was reluctant to talk to me. He hesitated and hemmed and hawed. I finally got the interviews done, did the piece, and on the week before the piece was to appear in the Washington Post Sunday paper, brought a copy of the magazine, several copies in fact, to him, for him to see, for him to sign for some of his friends. And it was at this point, as I say, Justice Marshall could be a difficult personality, could be cantankerous, could be grumpy. It was at this point that I thought I would ask him a very difficult set of questions about the legacy of Brown. And I kind of got it all out in one breath. I said, Justice Marshall, I was looking at some statistics recently, and I noticed that the level of segregation in America's public schools today, which is 1990 that I'm speaking of, the level of segregation in America's public schools today is about what it was when you came to this court back in 1967. Does it ever lead you to have any doubts, any questions about what happened back in 54? Because as I recall, after 54, you went around the country giving speeches in which you said, we'll be free by 63, the 100th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation. There was such excitement back in 54. And I said, it's not only that we have such high levels of segregation in America's public schools today, but in fact, if you look at the federal courts, you can see that the federal judges seem to have tired of court-ordered mandates for school integration. They are undoing them, they are ending these decrees, they're saying that we have so much residential segregation in America that it's an unfair burden to ask America's schools to achieve a social end, integration of our people. And as a result, they're pulling back from that goal. And I said, you know, it's even more puzzling to me when I think back to 54 as a young person who was born in 54 to come across parents in so many cities now who say to me they really don't want to put their child on a bus, another bus, to go across town for half an hour or 45 minutes. What they want, they say, is neighborhood schools where they can easily access the PTA, go visit the teacher, join in sports events at the school. But they say they're tired of having their children used in a social experiment. In addition, you know what? Sometimes they say white teachers and these white schools are not exactly welcoming warm places for their children, and that they believe that their children can get just as good an education in the neighborhood. And then, I don't want to seem as if I was prescient here, but I pulled out of my pocket an article I had recently read from the Howard University Law Review that was written by a man who was later to succeed Justice Marshall on the court, Clarence Thomas. And I said, look at this article, Justice Marshall. In this article, this young man is making the case that you made a mistake back in 54 when you centered on integration as the be-all and end-all of the 1954 Brown decision. Because what this young man is saying is that you should have instead focused on the idea of quality education for all children. That if you had focused on quality education, then we wouldn't have had all this investment of time and money to deal with the social discussion of desegregation as opposed to absolutely getting the best education for every American child, regardless of their skin color. Now, I just said a whole lot. I was talking for a little bit, and Justice Marshall had stopped looking at me, and I feared that this was finally the point when he would say, look, you gotta go. This is too much. But instead, he looked up, and he said to me, I must say that the first impression I had was of a man who was looking at someone who he felt had just walked in the middle of a movie, as if I really didn't understand all that had taken place. But he looked up and he said to me, there were things that have happened in the 40 years, because remember when this conversation was taking place, there are things that happened in the 40 years since 54 that he could not have anticipated. And he began by saying he could not have anticipated the tremendous growth in terms of the Latino population in the country. He said he couldn't have anticipated the tremendous immigrant growth. He couldn't have anticipated that it would have resulted in so many of the big cities in the country having concentrated populations of black and Hispanic children in their public schools. He said he couldn't have anticipated the decrease in the number of school-aged white children available to be integrated with those black and Latino students. Then he said, you know, I couldn't have anticipated the level of massive resistance that came to try to block school integration in this country. Couldn't have anticipated, he said, that the next year the court would have ruled that the various jurisdictions across the country could take all the time they needed, could engage in what they called all deliberate speed rulings with regard to school integration. So he said he couldn't have anticipated that so little would have been done even 10 years after Brown was law. And then he said, you know what, I couldn't have anticipated that 20 years after Brown, this court, because we were in his chambers in the Supreme Court, that 20 years after Brown, the Supreme Court would have ruled that suburban jurisdictions had no obligation to participate in desegregation plans with big cities and big city school districts. And he said, basically, at that point, what you understood was that given the tremendous rate of white flight and the decreasing population of young white people in the country that it was going to be almost impossible to achieve high levels of school desegregation without some other instrument, magnet schools, special plans in order, put in place in order to try to achieve desegregation. He says in terms of real desegregation, it wasn't going to be possible. But then he said the biggest change, the biggest point that he could not have anticipated back in 1954 was truly the lack of energy, the sense of fatigue that had crept across the country as people had since given up on this idea that integration was key to equal educational opportunity. He said, you know, his goal had never been to create some Norman Rockwell picture of a black child seated next to a white child, seated next to a Hispanic child, seated next to an Asian child, and on and on. He said the goal was to achieve equality in terms of educational opportunity. And if you'll recall, he said to me, and I think he said it with a bit of a disparaging glance, if you'll recall, he said, access was everything. Black children were being denied access to the very best schools because of the color of their skin. And as such, he said, the goal was to make sure that access in the future was always going to be possible because, and here he paused to say, you have to understand, it's so hard to communicate the look on his face, but here he said, you have to understand that what was going on in this country was intentionally denying people education, intentionally denying people the opportunity to compete in the society. He said, you have to keep in mind the theory that when the majority population operates, and here he's talking about the white population, our understanding was they were always going to protect the interests of their own children. They were always going to provide the best facilities, the best resources, the best faculty for their children. And our hope, our dream, our goal was to simply make sure that black children would also have access to those very same schools. And as a result, the majority population would therefore have an interest in making sure that good schools were available to black children as well. That was our point of leverage. Now, what had been a celebratory moment, my coming by with these glossy magazines with his pictures on the cover, had turned into a rather sad moment. He seemed rather downcast, somewhat disappointed in me for bringing up such a serious topic, maybe spoiling the party. And I must say that as I left that day, went outside the doors of the Supreme Court, I went into a city, Washington, D.C., where you could see what some call hyper-segregation in the public schools that were more than 90% black, disproportionately poor. If you went beyond the boundaries of the district, you went into some of the most affluent suburbs in America, Montgomery County, Maryland, Fairfax County, Virginia, and guess what? Extraordinary public schools with extraordinary results in terms of the education being offered to those young people. And I often thought to myself, you know, Justice Marshall had taken the time to respond honestly to me. But in a way, I felt as if he had not told me in that answer so much as what he had told me in the previous interviews over the previous 6 months that we had been talking. Because in a sense, I think he felt like I was a man who had walked in the middle of a movie and that I should have known better. I should have known more. Because when I first sat down with Justice Marshall, he had started off by telling me about his own childhood, born in 1908 in Baltimore, Maryland. His mother was a kindergarten teacher. And when he told me about his mother being a kindergarten teacher, he mentioned how she was a kindergarten teacher in segregated schools, that she was paid less than the white kindergarten teachers. He talked about the lack of facilities, resources available to her as a teacher, about the high number of black children in Baltimore City who didn't even go to school because they didn't have space for them to get an education. But then he had gone on talking about his family, and he began to talk about experiences such as going to a segregated high school in Baltimore, the only high school for young black people in the whole city, Frederick Douglass High School, and again about the inferior facilities there. And then he was talking, you know, it's not all of one tone or attitude. He's talking about going to high school with people like Cab Calloway, the jazz singer, going down to Pimlico, renting off the horses to make some money. Can you imagine those two? And then they go off to Pennsylvania Avenue, you know, the black business and entertainment district, and they're going to listen to the very best jazz singers and musicians. And there's Cab Calloway and Thurgood Marshall hanging out, playing tricks on the sailors who come up from Annapolis to have a night. I mean, it's an incredible scene in my mind. And then, of course, he goes off to college. And when he goes off to college, again, this issue of school segregation plays a key role, because he goes off to Lincoln University in Oxford, Pennsylvania. And when he goes off to this college, it is called the Black Princeton, because at the time, Princeton University in New Jersey had been created by the Presbyterian Church for bright, young, white men. Lincoln University in Pennsylvania was created by the Presbyterian Church for bright, young, black men. He goes off to this school, but there are no black people on the faculty at Lincoln. The Presbyterian Church hasn't allowed for this. Marshall comes into this school, and if you met Marshall at this time, by his own description, he's nothing but a big frat boy, a party animal, always smoking a cigarette, making plans to go party up in Philadelphia or go down to Baltimore for a good time. This is Thurgood Marshall. I don't think you would have said, oh, there's our future Supreme Court justice. Marshall was the kind of guy, just to give you a sense of things, the kind of guy who would urge a cow up into the president's office and feed him Epsom salt so the cow might have diarrhea right there. That's the kind of thing he was up to. And Marshall's the kind of guy who would tell the football team going off to play Howard or Hampton, go out there and hit the other team so hard their mamas feel it. But you would notice he's not on the team. He's not playing the game. Marshall had very little social or political consciousness during this period because, of course, he swam in a sea of segregation. And the reality of school segregation was just part of the fabric, part of the tone, the attitude of his life. So in the midst of his junior year, when an older student, about 26, comes back to finish his college degree, Marshall is shocked when this student, Langston Hughes, says to him, Thurgood, you're a big man on campus. You have so much to say about fraternity life and parties, chasing girls. But I notice you never have anything to say about the fact that there are no black people on the faculty here at Lincoln. And Marshall's attitude is, man, get out of my face. You know, I came here to have a good time, to meet some women, join the fraternity. I didn't come here to talk about politics and race. Your problem is you should have graduated some years ago. That's your problem. And so pretty much dismisses Langston Hughes and finishes it off by making the point, you know, if we had black people on the faculty here, they might belong to one fraternity or another, and then therefore show favoritism to students who belong to one fraternity or another, so it just wouldn't work. And what would people at other historically black schools think about us anyway if we had a sudden rush of black people coming onto the faculty? They might think it means we're not as good a school as we've said to have been. This was Thurgood Marshall speaking. So, you know what? Fate intervenes. I think sometime in all our lives we understand that somehow larger forces come to play, sometime on the simplest stage. Because Marshall just loved Western movies. Loved them. Loved the drama. So one Saturday afternoon, he and a group of his friends decide they're going to go down to the movie theater to watch a cowboy and Indian movie. They get down there, and of course, black people are supposed to sit up in the balcony. The lower seating bowl is reserved for white people. So Marshall and his friends buy their tickets, and they go up into the balcony area. But they go up there with a plan. The plan is that once the lights go down and the movie starts, they're going to slip down into the lower seating area. Well, the lights do go off. The movie starts. The young men get up, slide down into the lower seating area. But wouldn't you know it, the usher notices this. The one usher, the same person who was the ticket seller. And she calls the one policeman in this small town who comes, and now the lights go on and the movie is stopped and the boys are rousted from their seats and they go running back to campus fearing arrest. And when they get back to campus, because it's such a small community of black people in this rural white area of Pennsylvania, the word spreads almost instantaneously about what happened to Thurgood Marshall and his pals. And within a matter of hours that day, there's a knocking at Thurgood Marshall's dorm room door. It's none other than Langston Hughes. And he's saying, I told you so. This is what's going on in this country. Paid your money, didn't get to see your movie, did you? Now, I happen to be the father of a boy who's about 20-something years old. I don't want you folks to think that I'm a silly person, because I know people that age never admit to being wrong about anything. That's just a part of their nature. So I don't want you to think that Thurgood Marshall said, oh yeah, I'm wrong, Langston. But what I can tell you as the biographer is that within a matter of weeks, in the student paper, you suddenly see quotes with Thurgood Marshall's name attached to it, saying things like, if we want black people to trust us to be their dentists, their doctors, their accountants, their lawyers, how is it that we won't trust other black people to be our professors? And now, working with Langston Hughes and his sociology professor, Marshall gets a referendum going on campus, a referendum in which the students would ask the administration to allow black people to serve on the faculty. Well, the first time around, the referendum fails. Langston Hughes graduates, Marshall comes back, and again, working with his sociology professor, gets the referendum going. And this time, the referendum is a success. And the year after Marshall graduates from Lincoln, the first black person comes onto the faculty at the school. Now, Marshall has a new awareness of his potential for creating social change, and a new sense of, you know what, there are limits in this world that we have to fight. He tells his parents that he wants to go to law school. But of course, the law school that he wants to go to, the one that's most affordable, is the University of Maryland Law School, a law school that's just a few blocks down the street from where his parents live in West Baltimore. And it's the most affordable, of course. But the University of Maryland Law School does not accept people of color, so Marshall does not even apply. Instead, his mother has to pawn her wedding ring and her engagement ring to pay his first year tuition to Howard University Law School in Washington, D.C. And Marshall has to get up at 5 a.m. to take a train to Washington to get to school on time. And when he shows up in 1930, he's one of 36 students who are lined up that morning to meet the dean, a man named Charles Hamilton Houston. Houston looks at the 36 of them and says, look to your left, look to your right, two of the three of you won't be here to graduate in 3 years. Marshall's response to himself, of course, was to think, who is this guy? Mr. Cement Shoes, Mr. Iron Pants, he thinks he's so tough. But let me just tell you, Dean Houston wasn't bluffing. Only 6 of the 36 would graduate in 3 years. So the odds were even worse than what he was advertising. Because Houston was all about creating literally a boot camp for black lawyers. He wanted to create a proving ground that would produce the very best black legal talent America had ever seen. Houston had done a study during the 1920s in which he discovered there were only about 1,000 black lawyers in all the United States. Only 100 of them working in the South, where most black people live. And when he asked judges about the quality of representation being offered by these black lawyers, the answer was almost universally that it was inferior representation because these lawyers were so poorly educated. Their briefs were filled with misspellings, misunderstandings of the law. Houston had a higher goal. What he wanted to do was to get black lawyers who could not only represent clients, but go beyond that to understand how the law could be used to enforce their rights and privileges in this country. And so he decided to take over control of the Howard University Law School and make it from a nighttime, part-time operation into a full-time, daytime school. And he did so at some cost, because people said, you know, some of the members of the faculty here have to work on the faculty to support their legal practices out in the community, and how are people going to work here during the day and have practices outside? They're going to have to leave. It's going to make for difficult choices. So many of the students come here to school at night, part-time students. How are they going to go to school? You're going to have to force people out of school. It's not fair what you're doing. Houston ignored them all and created this top-notch law school. And in the first class, here is young Thurgood Marshall. Well, after the first year, Marshall's mother doesn't have to worry about pawning anything else because he's the top student in the law school. In fact, he becomes the law school librarian. And at one point, Dean Houston uses him as an associate, if you will, as he begins to represent people involved in racial issues in the vicinity. In one case, a man is accused of killing two white women in Leesburg, Virginia, just across the river. And the man flees to Massachusetts, fearing that he's going to be lynched. Well, the NAACP asked Houston to try to block the extradition. And working with Marshall and other lawyers on the law school faculty, they try to stop it, they're unable to. Then the trial is held. And Marshall is literally at the table getting sandwiches, getting anything he can to help Houston and the other lawyers represent this man. And of course, the case is made that there is no motive, there's no witness, there's no evidence of this man being involved, but the verdict comes back guilty. A life sentence is pronounced. After the life sentence is announced, Marshall's noticed that the man's family is full of cheer, that they're coming over to congratulate Dean Houston. Marshall's upset. He can't believe that they've lost this case. He thinks this is evidence of the racism in this court. Finally, he grabs Dean Houston. He says, you know, what's everybody celebrating about? We just lost. This is a wrong. Houston says to him, Thurgood, you don't get it. If these people genuinely thought that this man had killed two white women, they would have sentenced him to death. This man will be in jail for us to appeal, for us to make efforts to get this sentence reduced. You have to understand what we're dealing with here. Marshall writes home to his mother to say, you know, Mom, they talk about the power of black preachers. They talk about the power of black politicians. But if your life is on the line, you want a good lawyer. And that's what I want to be. I want to be a good lawyer. Now, after Marshall graduated in class of 33, the other day I was over at Howard University's law school. Former mayor of Baltimore, Kurt Schmoke, is now the dean there. And we were looking at pictures on the wall. When you come to the class of 33, you realize there's no picture. There's a picture of every other class of Howard University students. There's no picture of this celebrated class of 33 that includes so many of the lawyers who were involved in the Brown case. He said, you know, it's just a puzzle to me. I said, it's not a puzzle, Kurt, because the reason is that Thurgood Marshall and some of the other students were from different fraternities. They could never agree or set a time for this taking of this picture. So the picture was never taken. But once Marshall graduates, it's the post-depression era, and a young black lawyer can't get much work. And Dean Houston, who by this time is working with the NAACP to look at the disparate conditions of schools available to black and white students throughout the country, invites Marshall to take a trip with him. Take a trip with him down south. And so they get into an old car. Remember, these are two black men traveling through the south in 33. They've got to have blankets and pillows on the back seat because they don't know of any hotel is going to accept them as guests at night. They've also got bags of food and fruit on the back seat because they don't know that they'll always have a place to eat. And they've got cameras and notepads for taking notes and building this case, and so off they go, stopping along the way in school, sometimes unable to stop and visit at the white school because they won't even allow them into the school. They get down into the Mississippi Delta, way down into the south, just before the Louisiana border in rural Mississippi. They come to an old shack, not building, shack of a school. And when I say shack, I mean four wooden walls. And I mean no roof, In that movie we saw a clip of earlier, they talked about tar paper shacks, but those were buildings. But this was a tar paper shack with just four wooden walls and tar paper stretched over the top. No carpet, no floor, just dirt. And on a rainy day, the floor becomes thick with mud. That's what I'm talking about. The teacher didn't have a blackboard. She had a piece of coal that she would scrawl on the wall with to write something out for the students. And the black kids only went to school in the months of December, January, and February, when there weren't crops to be put in the ground or crops to be harvested. And most black kids didn't even bother to go. These were the conditions for black children in this small community in terms of education. Dean Houston is inside the building taking pictures, taking notes, talking with the teacher. Later, he's going to go down and try to take pictures of the brick building that is used to educate young white people in this community. He's inside this building when suddenly he hears from outside screams, "Stop it! What the hell is wrong with you? Are you crazy? What are you doing? Stop it!" Dean Houston thinks, "Oh my God, some crazy segregationist is attacking my young law student, Thurgood Marshall." Well, what's happened is this. While Houston had been in the building, Marshall was outside eating a sandwich, his lunch. A little boy approached. A little boy stared at Marshall, didn't say a word. Marshall at first thought the kid was never seen anybody like him. He was pretty impressed with the fact that he had just graduated from law school. The kid was kind of weird though, so he keeps looking at Thurgood Marshall. So finally Thurgood thought, well, maybe he's hungry, and he tears off a piece of the sandwich to offer to the child. But the child shakes his head. He doesn't want the sandwich. Marshall's thinking, what is with this kid? The kid then points at an orange that Marshall had been saving for his dessert and placed on the hood of the car. Marshall didn't want to give up that orange. He had been saving it. He wanted it. It was going to be his treat. But he said, all right, take the orange, and gives it to the child, who takes the orange and bites at it right through the rind. And then, reacting to the bitter taste of the rind, pulls the orange from his mouth, and now the juice, the pulp, goes spraying across his cheeks and chin. Some of it gets into his eye and stings his eyes, and now the kid takes the orange and flings it down on the ground in disgust. And that's when Thurgood Marshall goes apoplectic. He says, what the hell are you doing? Stop it. You crazy? Why are you doing this? What's wrong with you? Wasting my orange. And Dean Houston, hearing the commotion, comes racing out of the building. He says, Thurgood, what's going on? What's going on? He sees there's no crazy segregation. It's just this little boy. And Houston looks at him and says, you know, explain. Why are you screaming at this child? And Marshall says, Dean Houston, you don't understand. This kid took my orange. He bit at it right through the rind like he's a crazy person. And then he smushed it all over his face. Look at his face. It's still on his face. And now he's taken it and thrown the orange on the ground and wasted my orange. Wasted it. And Dean Houston looks at him and says, you know, Thurgood, I signed your law degree. But I don't think you understand what's going on here. He says, you know, we stop when some of these families take us in for a night. We eat something. We have to go to the bathroom. You notice we have to go out back. When we go out to this outhouse, they got open troughs right there in the backyard filled with human waste because these people have no plumbing. They have no electricity. And then he said, you notice we don't see any factories, we don't see any office buildings as we've been driving along, not for days. He says, you know why that is, Thurgood? That's because if people here want a job, they have to go to the man in the big house and ask him for a piece of land in which they could be sharecroppers. That's all they have in terms of economic opportunity. And when it comes to educating the next generation in this community, Thurgood, and here he turned and he pointed at this shack behind him. He says, when it comes to educating the next generation in this community, Thurgood, this is what these people have to offer their children. And you're going to stand here and you're going to scream and shout at this little boy because he doesn't know anything about peeling an orange, slicing an orange, picking the seeds out of an orange. He says, damn it, Thurgood, kid's never seen an orange. And you're doing nothing but embarrassing me, embarrassing yourself, and embarrassing this child. Thurgood Marshall was stunned. He couldn't believe that there was an 8-year-old in America that had never seen, much less eaten, an orange. It was inconceivable to him, beyond his ability to understand, because he grew up in Baltimore and eaten oranges all his life, couldn't believe it. That night he writes home to his mother, "Dear Mom, you know, Dean Houston has been telling us all through law school that a lawyer who's not a social engineer is nothing but a social parasite. And I didn't know what he was talking about because I went to law school to make you proud. I wanted to be Lawyer Marshall. I wanted to make some money." He says, "But today I met an 8-year-old who didn't know what an orange is. Couldn't believe it. But I'm struck by the idea that somebody should be a voice for that child in American life." And he goes on to detail how people in the community don't send their children to this shack of a school to talk about what goes on in the school, and to say that he wants to be a voice for people who have only that school to offer the next generation. Marshall goes back home to Baltimore. As I mentioned, there's not much work for him as a young black lawyer in this period after the Great Depression. But he has a grudge that he desperately wants to satisfy. The grudge is against the University of Maryland Law School. And so he gets a friend by the name of Donald Gaines Murray, who was a graduate of Amherst, to fill out an application to the University of Maryland Law School. And, you know, Donald Gaines Murray says, "Thurgood, this is futile. I mean, if anybody should know this is a waste of time, it's you, because you didn't even bother to apply. You know they don't accept people of color." But Marshall helps him get the money up, and they send in the application. When it comes back, it's stamped denied. Marshall doesn't get upset. He encourages Donald Gaines Murray to send a letter to the university president asking why someone who's an honors graduate of Amherst, a lifelong resident of the state of Maryland, would be denied admission to the state's law school. So off goes this letter, and a few weeks later, a handwritten letter comes back from the university president saying that the University of Maryland Law School does not accept people of color. Marshall is ecstatic, just thrilled, because now he's got the policy explicitly stated, signed by the university president, and he uses it as the basis for a lawsuit against the University of Maryland Law School. Now he knows that he's up against a segregationist political structure that appoints segregationist judges, and he knows that most of these judges have graduated from the University of Maryland Law School, so he knows he's in for a fight. But he thinks, you know what, 5, 10, 15 years, something's gonna come of this lawsuit. Well, wouldn't you know it, there's a judge at the very lowest level in Baltimore City Court who calls the case. Marshall brings Donald Gaines Murray and Dean Houston with him. The lawyer for the university stands up and he says, "Your Honor, the university intends to create a separate law school for blacks in a distant county, Anne Arundel County, at some date, but the state legislature has not appropriated the money necessary to build that law school. But please don't be impatient with us, and please don't think about integrating the University of Maryland Law School, because it would do nothing but damage the reputation of the law school and diminish its ability to educate such fine lawyers as yourself." Thurgood Marshall stands up and he says, "Your Honor, under the 1896 Plessy v. Ferguson decision, separate but equal is the law of the land. And if you don't have a separate and equal law school for educating young black people in the state of Maryland, then you must integrate the existing facility." And he sits down, and then there are arguments over witnesses that are going to testify, over what kind of evidence is going to be introduced. It's the end of the day. They come back the next day. And much to their surprise, the judge asks everyone to stand and announces that Donald Gaines Murray is to be admitted to the University of Maryland Law School. Wow. Marshall is so stunned by this, I got to tell you, that according to the transcript, the court record in Annapolis, the state capital of Maryland, the archives there, Marshall turns to Donald Gaines Murray and says, "What did he say?" Couldn't believe what the judge had said. And I got to tell you, you know, for me, there's no indication in the court record what Murray responds, but I've often thought to myself, Man, Don Gaines Murray must have been tripping because, you know, he was helping his friend out. He didn't intend to go to law school for 3 years. I mean, that's asking a lot, you know, you gotta go to law school. Well, Dean Houston takes that case and he uses it then as a precedent, as a template, if you will, because by now he's working full time with the NAACP Legal Defense Fund in New York and begins to challenge segregation of graduate professional schools, first in Missouri, then in Oklahoma, then in Texas. And now what you're seeing is these schools are failing because they can't create quickly enough these separate black schools to educate black people. And finally, when the Supreme Court gets these cases on appeal, the Supreme Court says that even if you created a sudden law school and said it is the black law school, how could it ever be the equal of a long-standing state institution with its faculty, its libraries, its alumni networks, and all the rest? It could never be truly equal. So the Supreme Court does everything but overturn separate but equal Plessy v. Ferguson. By this time, of course, Thurgood Marshall has succeeded Dean Houston as the head of the Legal Defense Fund. And Marshall has been involved in so many cases trying to battle against the laws of segregation. Undoing the laws of restrictive covenants that kept blacks and Jews from buying property in the better neighborhoods of this country, saying that it was an illegal contract that couldn't be enforced. Battling against the use of the all-white primary, the Democratic Party that kept black people, Hispanics, and women from voting in the primaries. Battling with people over segregation in the military, going so far as to travel to Japan and South Korea to argue with General MacArthur over the treatment of blacks in the military. This was all work done by Thurgood Marshall. And now comes the challenge of how to confront segregation in elementary and secondary schools. And the idea is put forth by Dean Houston and others, reluctantly accepted by Marshall, that they shouldn't even directly challenge Plessy, separate but equal. But what they should do now is reach out to the Constitution, to the 14th Amendment, to the requirement of equal protection under the law for all citizens regardless of race, and say that segregated schools at the elementary and secondary level is a violation of that 14th Amendment. And of course, it's going to be a challenge because the reality is that when the Congress passed the 14th Amendment, they later created a very segregated school system in the District of Columbia and had never interpreted as requiring school integration. But Marshall and the lawyers for the NAACP make the case. His opponent, John W. Davis, the man who was the lawyer of his time, the man who had been head of the American Bar Association, a man who had run for president in 1924 as a Democrat, makes the case that, in fact, what we're doing here is sacrificing a necessary system of separate education that is appropriate for the children, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren of slaves. And he uses the analogy of a dog who has a piece of meat in its mouth and sees its reflection in a body of water and drops what it has in its mouth to reach out for what doesn't exist, what's just an illusion, and loses everything. And says, in fact, that black children would not be welcome in integrated schools, would not feel welcome, would not be well-educated, and it would lead to a disaster. Marshall comes back and responds in the second set of hearings in December of 53 by saying, in essence, that John W. Davis wants to simply confirm an inferior status on all black people for all time. And now, 50 years ago, on May 17th, 1954, Chief Justice Earl Warren, seated on that bench at the Supreme Court in Washington, D.C., accompanied by all other 8 justices of the High Court on that day, said in a unanimous ruling, that in the area of public education, separate but equal is so damaging in ways unlikely ever to be undone that it is illegal and must be ended. And that day truly marked a landmark in terms of Supreme Court history. Now, Marshall could not have anticipated all the changes that were to come. I told you, when he spoke to me, I felt like he was speaking to a man who'd come in the middle of a movie. Because he didn't repeat all the struggles that he had been through, all the realities of separation, of inferior schools. He didn't even mention to me the reality of going forward in terms of the tremendous changes that Brown had created in American life. He didn't talk about the idea of increased rates of graduation for black students in this country. He didn't talk about the creation of a black middle class in this country as a result of the increased rate of education and graduation rates that took place in the black community after Brown. He didn't talk about Brown as sparking a civil rights revolution, creating a heightened level of expectation and energy among people who believed in integration, and now for the first time believed that their dream could come true. People who took part in things like the Montgomery bus boycott, who took part in freedom rides and lunch counter sit-ins and freedom marches and freedom summers. Didn't talk about any of that. Didn't talk about the idea of black political empowerment growing out of that increased black middle class in American life. He just spoke in terms of the argument over Brown and the immediate legacy in terms of America's public schools and the struggle with the idea, the thesis that he had pursued back in 54 versus the reality that he was seeing toward the end of his life in 1990. And Marshall, as I said, had a sense of sadness when he was speaking to me about all that had taken place, never doubted that what he had done was right, that he had pursued the right theory. But there was a sense of sadness at what had taken place, in a sense as if many people in the society would doubt that Brown had truly created a revolution in terms of American public education. So I think that Thurgood Marshall would have been surprised that when he died, Chief Justice Rehnquist, a man with which he had many an argument, would ask that the wooden structure that had been used to bear the body of Abraham Lincoln be brought out of storage and placed in the Great Hall of the Supreme Court, and that Thurgood Marshall's casket be placed there, and that people be allowed to walk by and pay their last respects to Thurgood Marshall. And the announcement that this was taking place was made on the day that it was happening. It was kind of a sudden thing, of course, of death and the sudden arrangements made with the family. So by late afternoon, there was a line of people down the steps, the white marble steps of the Supreme Court. And now the idea was, well, it looks like it's going to be hard to close the doors to the court at 5:30, 6 o'clock when the court normally is shut. So they were going to allow the court to remain open until 8. But by 8 o'clock, and I'm not talking to you, you have to realize, we're talking Washington, D.C. in early February, it was bitterly cold. In fact, it was unseasonably cold. So cold that the line of people looked almost like a train because their breaths were turning white in the air, and they were standing there shivering in the night. The decision is made, they can't close the court. They couldn't even close the court at 8 o'clock. They're going to keep it open until 10 or 11 o'clock. But by 10 or 11 o'clock, the line had extended now down the steps, along First Street, and down Maryland Avenue, for those of you who are familiar with the location of the court, down Maryland Avenue. They couldn't close the court again at midnight. And they had to call the Chief Justice and request that they allow it to stay open. He said it was okay, but he asked how long the line was, and he had to be told the line was now so long it was headed toward Union Station. And they couldn't close the court at 2 or 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And people would come by and they would leave flowers. They would leave pictures of themselves attending segregated schools. They would leave pictures of themselves holding their parents' hands, walking in for their first day of integrated schools. People would stand there and break down in tears talking about what had happened in their lives and their children's lives as a result of Brown and as a result of the efforts of lawyers led by Thurgood Marshall. They couldn't ever close the doors. They just had to finally tell people that they were moving the casket over to the National Cathedral for the funeral. And all three major networks at the time canceled their afternoon programming to carry the funeral live. And Chief Justice Rehnquist stood up and he said what a gift it was to have Thurgood Marshall in the judicial conferences to give the other justices of the Supreme Court something they had never had before, an understanding of the unequal justice that had been given to black people in America, and that Marshall's presence really had helped to balance the scales of justice in this nation. And then Vernon Jordan, the famous lawyer, stood up and he said that when Thurgood Marshall would come to help people in some small town, that they would all scream out, "Thurgood's a coming, Thurgood's a coming," in a way that people might talk of an angel being sent by the hand of God to rescue them from some terrible situation. And then President Clinton stood up. And President Clinton said he was speaking as a white man and a white Southerner. And he said, "I could never have been elected president without the Brown decision and the work of the man that we honor here today, Thurgood Marshall. Because there would not have been a black vote in this country. And that black vote would not have understood me as a Southern politician and would not have allowed me to rise up and to be elected governor of Arkansas and go on to run for this office if it had not been for the Brown decision and Thurgood Marshall." And then they took the casket, the body, of course, they took it up to Arlington National Cemetery, where it's buried now, not far from the eternal flame that's on John F. Kennedy's grave. And on that day, I gotta tell you, I was filled with emotion. I was thinking to myself, you know, Thurgood Marshall died having the sense that times had passed him by, that people questioned the legacy of Brown. People might have viewed him as someone who time had passed by. But I think that in that moment, he would have had the sense of how deeply he had touched this country's heart and how much change he had created in this society. Change to such an extent that people couldn't even recognize America from the America that existed when he was born in 1908 under Plessy v. Ferguson in Separate but Equal. Change to such an extent that we argue today about the legacy of Brown in continuing ways with our arguments about 209, about affirmative action, about busing. That Marshall changed America and American law and the reality of our ideals of what we see as right and just for our children in such elemental ways that it's sometimes hard for us to remember what America was like before Thurgood Marshall. This afternoon, someone said to me, we were talking with a group of students, someone said to me, "Juan, why would you call a book about Thurgood Marshall, someone who worked within the system his entire life, American revolutionary?" And I said, well, to my mind, if you are able to overturn Plessy v. Ferguson in your lifetime, when you are born under those laws, you have accomplished a revolution. But it doesn't stop there. It's much more. It seems to me to be also a revolution when you can go forward and impact so many areas of American life in the way that Thurgood Marshall did. And tonight, I'm speaking to all of you on this 50th anniversary of Brown. I just want to say to you that we are here tonight not so much to celebrate the Brown decision of 50 years ago as to commemorate and to understand that each and every one of us in this room has to inherit a mantle, a responsibility from the likes of Justice Marshall. Inherit a mantle of responsibility that would say that we still struggle to try to deliver on the promise of equal education for all children. That 50 years from today, people will be looking back and asking of each and every one of us if we understood this critical moment in American history, if we were able to rise up and face the demands and challenges of our day and our generation in a way that's comparable to what Marshall and his fellows did in their day. That is the challenge for us in this moment, and it would be the greatest way in which we could say thank you to a generation that truly delivered on the promise of equality for all. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. My name is Anika McKeezy. I'm currently the undergraduate student body president here at UCLA. I have the pleasure of introducing one of our speakers tonight, but before I segue into that, I want to paint a picture for you all. Our university is in a crisis. In this fall's incoming freshman class, approximately 9,000 students were admitted. Of those 9,000, only 199 are of African descent. Now, the face of the university is drastically changing with the implementation of Standing Policy 1 and 2 in the UC system and Proposition 209 across the state have both further magnified the disparities in the K-12 educational system while virtually eliminating the presence of Black students within higher education. Added to this, we see increases in student fees, cuts to financial aid, and the implementation of restrictive academic policies, making the retention and graduation of students of color more and more difficult within the university system. This is why it becomes increasingly important to affirm the work of Black intellectuals who critically challenge a system that continually attacks the Black community. And this is why we're here today. I'm here today to introduce a woman whose intellectual prowess and savviness and strength continues to help lead the Black community. Kimberle Crenshaw has received degrees from Cornell University, the University of Wisconsin, and Harvard University, and is currently a professor at UCLA and Columbia Law School. Writing in the areas of civil rights, Black feminist legal theory, race, racism, and the law, her articles have appeared in the Harvard Law Review, the National Black Law Journal, Stanford Law Review, and Southern California Law Review. She is the founding coordinator of the Critical Race Theory Workshop and the co-editor of a volume, Critical Race Theory, Key Documents That Shaped the Movement. Professor Crenshaw has lectured widely nationally and internationally on race matters, addressing audiences throughout Europe, Africa, and South Africa. A specialist on race and gender equality, she has facilitated workshops for civil rights activists in Brazil and constitutional court judges in South Africa. In 2001, she authored the background paper on race and gender discrimination for the United Nations World Conference on Racism. In the domestic arena, she has served as a member of the National Science Foundation's Committee to Research Violence Against Women and has assisted the legal team representing Anita Hill. In 1996, she co-founded the African American Policy Forum to highlight the centrality of gender and racial justice discourses. Professor Crenshaw, former leader to MSNBC, is a founding member of the Women's Media Initiative and is a regular commentator on NPR's The Tavis Smiley Show. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's keynote, Kimberle Crenshaw.
Good evening to Darnell Hunt, to friends, the Ralph Bunche Center, colleagues. I want to first thank you for inviting me to offer some comments. I also want to thank Juan Williams for bringing Thurgood Marshall to life for us. Those stories are absolutely good. Juan had to leave us to catch a plane, and Connie Rice has also had to depart as well. So you're stuck with me for the rest of the evening. And I am somewhat challenged, actually, to figure out exactly what tone to strike in a commemorative moment such as this. I was looking at the program, and it's the 15th annual anniversary of the Thurgood Marshall Dinner, the 100th anniversary of the birth of Ralph Bunche, the 50th anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education, and the 35th anniversary of the founding of the Bunche Center. Now, I find commemorative events like these to be tricky business. Especially when the issue is the quest for racial justice. I remember several years ago I wrote about precisely this issue when we had to think about how to first celebrate the first commemoration of Martin Luther King Day. And I was struck when I received instructions from the Martin Luther King Commemorative Commission, which issued an edict to all of those recognizing the holiday. What they told us was to avoid any particular criticism of any particular public policy that might have particular effects of exacerbating racial injustice. We should avoid talking about the current state of race relationships or disparities, and by all means avoid any criticism of any current administrative policies. Instead, we were to focus on the societal consensus of the dream that galvanized the nation. Now, if there was ever an oxymoron that competed with all deliberate speed, I think the theme of the first commemoration was such an oxymoron. It was called Living the Dream. Now, I think this exemplifies how commemorations can easily slip into self-congratulations, and at worst, a whitewashing of some of the existing conditions that actually share more in common with the past that we're trying to get away from rather than the broad inclusive hopes for the future. So this year's celebration of the landmark case Brown versus Board of Education and the recognition of the contribution of Thurgood Marshall raise anew the challenge we face, and that is giving due regard to the landmark case while at the same time speaking truthfully to the continuities of exclusion and the lack of equal opportunity that contradict Brown's soaring aspirations. It's not a contradiction, interestingly enough, that Marshall himself was unfamiliar with. As tonight's speaker Juan Williams documented in his powerful biography of Marshall, he also grappled with the contradiction imposed by his need to continue to hail Brown versus Board of Education, alongside the fact that Brown too, the case that issued the remedy of all deliberate speed, placed this right against second-class citizenship in a second-class relationship with all other legal rights. Most of the time, rights are recognized and then immediately enforced. Not so with Brown versus Board of Education. The fact that less than 7% of all formerly segregated black students were attending desegregated schools 10 years after Brown was decided certainly must have been a bitter pill for this man to swallow, who, as Juan Williams said earlier today, had proclaimed by 1963 integration would be pretty much a done deal. This is a man who probably knew that in the real politic of social change, Brown too would contain the urgency that Brown 1 had created. But Marshall chose to grapple with the contradictions by deploying what I call a public-private split in his rhetoric. In public, he highlighted the principled commitment to integrated education, and he honored the Supreme Court, which created that right. But in private, he assailed the failure of heart and commitment exemplified not only by President Eisenhower, but ultimately by the Supreme Court itself. So these contradictions in the way of grappling with them are not new, both as expressed by what Thurgood Marshall had to deal with and by the King commemoration that I suggested earlier. This habit of politely but somewhat disingenuously muffling all contemporary critique behind the public face of celebration. Perhaps, though, as we move forward in the activities planned for this 50th anniversary, we can abandon this public-private split and regard this as an opportunity to fully regard the contradictions of this particular moment and, frankly, the contradictory legacy of those like Marshall, whose actions we often applaud, but at the same time reflect values that may contribute to the stalled progress on the front of racial equality. Perhaps we've reached a point where the value of the victory is safe enough and the reputations of our pioneers are great enough so that we might be able to confront the next stage of the struggle for racial justice head on rather than sideways. After all, it was by forcing the Supreme Court to face the contradictions between American democratic values and the reality of their wholesale denial that ushered the court into the contradiction closing gesture of striking down school desegregation laws. This journey would start, I would contend, with an honest assessment of the fact that the progress on the face of educational equity has stalled on virtually every level, and we're facing, frankly, reversal in K through 12 education all the way to higher education. Connie Rice, I believe, would have addressed the situation from the perspective of K-12 education. But it's doubtful, given all the press that's been received lately about the continuing integration of higher education, whether most Americans know of the crises facing African Americans in higher education and professional schools. Here at UC, for example, at our governor's request, admissions across the board are down 7%. African Americans constitute only 2.3% of admitted California students to UC schools. And this number is down from the prior 2 years, at which our levels of acceptance were 2.8 and 3.3%, respectively. In raw numbers, this amounts to admissions of 199 students of UCLA, and this doesn't even account for the yield rate, which is far less than that. Just to put this in perspective, we're talking, for example, of having just 24 non-athlete black males in a freshman class of nearly 4,000. Mind you, too, these declines are taking place relative to classes that had already experienced a decline in the aftermath of Prop 209, which, as you know, precluded admissions from considering race. Moreover, the 7% affects those who, due to effective outreach programs, managed to meet the requirements that were initially established for guaranteed enrollment in UC colleges. As increasing numbers of underrepresented students hear messages and ready themselves to be competitive along with the criteria that the university has set, the university then decides to shrink the pie. Not too surprisingly, the last to sit at the table are the least likely to be fed. Thus, the situation is not one that's likely to improve without drastic intervention. We're not talking about a slowed pace of advancement. We are talking about absolute reversal. Now, the sobering trend might cause another drop in enrollment is occurring at the professional schools that already are rebounding from the drop after 209. As those of you who are familiar with the law school might remember, in the same year that UCLA graduated its first majority-minority class, it went on in the fall to enroll a class with diversity numbers that were so low it rivaled those that occurred in 1967. Two African Americans and a little over a dozen Latinos were enrolled. After this devastation, the numbers slowly eat their way up with targeted outreach and Herculean efforts on the part of counselors, faculty members, and others. Yet another decline might be in sight next year and for years to come. You see, UCLA and Berkeley are the primary feeder schools for the law school. The tragic numbers, drop in numbers there will set a predicate for a continuing drop in enrollment at the professional school level, again, unless something dramatic is done. And for those of you who, like me, can't quite grapple with numbers in the abstract, perhaps this will help. Take the most dramatic drop that occurred right after 209 went into effect, when we graduated 40 African Americans and enrolled two the next year. Over a 10-year period, that's the difference between putting out 400 black lawyers as opposed to 20. Now, it's hard to tell whether the decline over the next 3 years will be as steep, but the picture is certainly sobering 50 years after Brown. Now, here we might be tempted to pine for the leadership of Thurgood Marshall to provide clarity and focus and precision in shaping an intervention to reverse this unexpected loss of momentum. After all, Thurgood Marshall, among the most articulate spokespersons for affirmative action, had written passionately in Bakke versus UC that the history of past discrimination required the University of California to redouble its efforts to recruit students of color to assume leadership and service roles to our various communities. Many of us are taken to contrast this moment that this unfaltering support given to affirmative action represents against those who are unfailingly critical of affirmative action, like his successor, Clarence Thomas. But here is where the contradiction that I spoke about presents itself. For Marshall himself may have failed to appreciate and target the full weight of the exclusionary barriers that contribute to this current crisis. While Marshall clearly saw the disparities in public education, limited upward trajectory of the children of apartheid, With respect to the fairness and race neutrality of existing criteria, the scope of his understanding did not often veer far from the opponents of affirmative action. For Marshall, affirmative action was a preference, a legitimate one to be sure, but a preference nonetheless, over existing standards that might otherwise be supportable. Yet a wealth of research today suggests that there are a host of barriers that continue to shape the life chances of African Americans, barriers that have little to do with talent and competitiveness and everything to do with flawed measures of merit and false beliefs about race neutrality of our existing educational practices. Claude Steele, for example, finds that stereotype threat, the fear of confirming a negative racial stereotype against your group that causes anxiety, heightened blood pressure, and even panic, actually suppresses the performance of African Americans on standardized tests, such as the LSAT and the SAT, tests that they could otherwise perform on par with whites, absent the threat. Other cognitive researchers suggest that there are an infinite number of subtle messages and practices that either suppress the classroom performances of African Americans, or worse still, repress the teacher's recollection of their superior performances or highlight negative performances of African American students. Other research suggests that tests alone, which account for a lion's share of the likelihood of admission to a competitive school, can predict less than 18% of a first year grade. Yet a poor test score can account for 100% of the likelihood of being admitted. In short, the belief that education is either in its process or measure race neutral is becoming increasingly falsifiable. Nonetheless, affirmative action policies, a modest correction for the lack of race neutrality in higher education, are routinely, and I would contend, inaccurately called racial preferences. So correctly understood, affirmative action to ensure race neutrality in distributing educational opportunities need not run afoul of 209. Race-sensitive admissions, in fact, might not be considered preferences at all. In light of all the evidence, it is the failure to take race into account that really is a race preferences. So it's nice to think in the end that Justice Marshall might stand firmly on this argument, and perhaps he might have come to this perspective in the by and by, but from a look at his own reliance on traditional measures of merit and institutional prestige, no matter how exclusionary they might be, Justice Marshall was far from the critic of these policies that we might have hoped. Indeed, in of nearly 100 law clerks hired by Justice Marshall during his tenure, only 7 were African Americans. Only 1 came from Howard, his alma mater, and that was his goddaughter, the daughter of Bill Hastie. Moreover, Marshall relied on a screening committee made up of members of the same law schools that couldn't find their way to hire black scholars in any sufficient numbers, accepting the same logic to justify largely white faculties that now justifies decreasingly diverse student bodies. They're just not enough of us qualified folk. Suffice it to say that if Thurgood Marshall, the young and upcoming lawyer who was bound to set a legal revolution, had come before Associate Justice Thurgood Marshall, the younger Marshall would not have been hired. Now, of course, defenders will say that Marshall himself hired more black law clerks than all of his colleagues combined, and this is true. Liberal Justice Brennan hired none, like his more conservative brethren. And much can be said about the court's reliance on the most qualified law students. But it strains credulity to think that only the best legal minds happened to graduate from 3 schools in the entire nation, happened to come to the attention of a half dozen or so elite white law professors, and happened to have the best LATs and GPAs to boot. It's sobering to say the least that the architect of the very movement to eliminate discrimination, root and branch, himself succumbed to its own reflection, albeit sanitized through objective numbers and glowing references. If Thurgood Marshall's personal legacy means anything, It's that one-size-fits-all measures of merit developed in moments when most African Americans couldn't darken the doors of America's premier institutions cannot predict with any degree of accuracy which minds will change the world and which minds will simply adapt to it. To put a point on it, Martin Luther King, the century's most gifted orator, fell to the bottom quintile in his verbal GREs. Something is definitely wrong when potential like that is missed, when one's entire future may rest on one high-stake test or the sheer luck of a personal connection. Both qualifications themselves are heavily shadowed by apartheid of the past and unthinking but exclusionary institutional cultures of higher education today. So some of you might think that this criticism of Marshall is inappropriate in light of his towering contributions to racial justice. But in my defense, I point to none other than Marshall himself as my exemplar. It was Marshall, you may remember, who dared to voice a note of critique during the bicentennial celebration of the Constitution, foregoing the hoopla and circumstance to focus instead on the profound struggle that was necessary to make a way for racial justice in the face of the Constitution's shameful contradictions. Marshall risked censure to remind us that racial struggle necessitated a direct engagement with the very logic of the Constitution, the apparently neutral, everyday assumptions that permitted racial inequality to flourish in the nation that promised otherwise. Taking his leadership to heart, perhaps we can best lift up his legacy by agreeing with him that there are no sacred cows in the quest for justice, that the way forward is through an unblinking assessment of the missed opportunities of the past and the tracks not yet taken by the conductors of our freedom train. I think that the crotchety, opinionated, and sometimes conservative Marshall remained a fighter for racial justice and a critic of all orthodoxy. That some of his own orthodoxies might be among those interrogated now and perhaps set aside, I would think would be met with his sense of biting irony. And if lucky, the bearer might find herself the center of one of his entertaining but provocative stories of struggle. Thank you very much.
Everyone for joining us in such an important evening. On behalf of the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies, I would like to thank you all again for joining us. We hope to see you again, though, next year. And please have a safe drive home. We have a lot to think about on the drive, so don't let that distract you as you grapple with the 405, the 10, and all those other freeways, highways, and byways. Thank you for coming. Take care.